everybody. I'm here with Christian Bilotti, GM of Global Foundation Services. Christian, thank you so much for coming down. I know you're a busy guy.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes,
he is.
It's
great to be here.
First of all, let's start at the beginning. What's Global Foundation Services?
Well, Global Foundation Services is really the infrastructure underlying the cloud. If you look at, we're essentially the networking team, we're the security team, we're also the automation team and the data center team. And the data center team is the team that I run.
Okay.
And it's a global organization. I've got people all over the globe. We're doing essentially my team, which is called Data Center Services, is responsible for site selection, building the data centers, engineering the data centers, and then running the data centers and filling them with servers.
Great. Now, we're going to take a little question that has a very broad answer, I'm sure. So, I don't think people are really familiar with the scope of what exactly goes on at a data center. So if you could sort of summarize here, like what happens at a data center?
Well, first of all, these data centers are monstrous.
Just physically in size.
Yeah, physically in size. If you look at a typical data center for us, look at our Quincy data center or our Chicago data center, they range anywhere, one building alone ranges anywhere from 15 to 20 times the size of a football field.
Wow.
So if you think of the scale of that size and filled with servers, it's hard to imagine.
Wow. Do you have your own power supply? How do these things run?
Oh, well, that's a great question. I mean, we use the utility. We work very closely with the utility industry. I have an energy team, and they specialize in working with the utilities.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the amount of power, we have to work very closely with the utilities, as you can imagine.
Yeah, absolutely.
Particularly in some parts of the world where there isn't that much power available. And so we're looking at all possibilities in terms of even self-power generation, as well as using utility power.
So it sounds like it's sort of always evolving. Can you talk about maybe how data centers have evolved, let's say in the last 5 years? You've been around that long at least?
Yep. Unfortunately, yeah.
I mean, in that industry.
But,
let's talk about how far we've come.
Well, I mean, there's been, particularly over my time here at Microsoft, which has been since 2007, when you look back at what data centers looked like at that time, they were essentially very traditional, large buildings, air-conditioned cavities, essentially. But what's evolved and what actually Microsoft has been a leader in is really changing what a data center is. Among the things we're doing is instead of using air conditioning systems, we're essentially using what they call airside economization. And that's simply you're opening up the windows. So instead of using the extra energy, and this is all to get more efficiency, instead of using extra energy by having an air conditioning system, we just open up the windows.
Think of that invention.
Yeah. God, the cavemen came up with that. Yeah. And so we draw in the air and just blow out the hot air rather than just keeping it all contained and air conditioning it.
So when looking for a location to build a data center, would you look for someone in a cooler climate?
Well, absolutely. And if you look at our Dublin data center, we were like the first business that went there and said, "We love your weather."
Right?
Most people don't like the Dublin weather, but it's ideal weather for us. However,
Perfect.
At the same time, we have to think about, you know, parts of the world, because we do have to get our data centers relatively close to the population.
Right.
And so in some cases, like Southeast Asia, we have data center in Singapore, Hong Kong, and places like that, we don't necessarily have that option. But we do look at evaluating just opening up the windows. But still, we may have to use air conditioning in those cases. Population is important. There's a bunch of different criteria that help us decide where to go. Weather, of course, is also a good one. And so we're constantly optimizing, right?
So would the new data centers be larger in size than the older ones? Are they constantly growing, or are you becoming more efficient in a smaller space?
Oh, that's a great question. If you think about, you know, Moore's Law, theoretically, Moore's Law was essentially you could put twice the transistors on a semiconductor every 2 years, which is the speed at which we could evolve. If you follow that law, you would think, oh, we should have like one chip to run all of our operations, right?
Data center in my pocket.
Yeah, that's right. But but if you think about it, what happened is, as computation gets cheaper and cheaper, and that's what Moore's Law enables, is the cheapening of computation. It's getting so cheap that all these new apps that there wasn't an ROI story for the previous year are now emerging as a great business. And so what we see is is it's called Jevons paradox, where if you make a resource, computation is a resource. Mm-hmm. If you make a resource cheap enough, then everyone runs and finds out ways to consume it and make businesses out of it and so on. And so what we see is data centers to date have been growing at approximately a rate of 15% a year.
Wow.
So, and we expect that trend to continue.
Okay. Now, you've recently won an award. I believe it was called the Data Center Dynamics for Outstanding Contribution to the Industry Award. First of all, what did you do to achieve this award?
So, first of all, let me just say I'm blessed to be part of this industry.
Great.
And any award you get in any industry is a result of a lot of people around that
sure.
have helped, right?
Sure.
And so, certainly the contribution, which you're asking about, was really an efficiency metric. Back in 2001 or so, up at 35,000 feet coming back from a customer, I was struggling with the customer on how I can tell them how to improve their efficiency. And they were struggling with listening to what they could do because they had no way to measure it. And so I was frustrated, and on at 35,000 feet on a 777 on American Airlines, I just came on this idea of something called PUE,
okay.
Power Usage Effectiveness in the Data Center. I did it just for this customer. Then the customer really liked it when I flew all the way back to Japan a few months later. And then I started sharing it with other customers. They liked it. And then before I knew it, I was like, well, maybe I should see what the industry thinks about this. And EPA liked it. The European Commission liked it. And before you knew, everyone started using this efficiency metric. And the great thing is, in the time that it's been public, the efficiency of data centers has improved by a factor of two. They use half the power they did before, and it was all because you can measure it. And so as a result, the recognition I'm getting, I think,
it's
has
amazing.
To do with this, really, this transformation of how we think of efficiency in a data center. With that, though, data centers have gotten much more efficient. The reality is that's kind of the past now, right? Now we have to start thinking about the next steps on how we evolve the data center, how we look at not just power efficiency, but how we look at computational efficiency coming out of a data center. And so that's what we're starting to look at now.
So you essentially created something that was the industry standard.
Yeah, yeah. Isn't that crazy?
That's amazing. I mean, that's got to be pretty proud for you to look back
awesome.
At not only your accomplishments, but the teams that you've worked on. And look what you've sort of contributed to this industry.
Yeah, it blows me away every time I think about it, because when I was on that plane, it was just to solve that customer's problem.
That's awesome. What a great story.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Now, here at Microsoft, we obviously are a software company, and I understand we're sort of using software to help in the efficiency of data centers going forward. Can you talk to me a little bit about that?
So one of the things that, if you can imagine, I explained the size and scale of these data centers we're building and the amount of power they use. The infrastructure is expensive.
Right.
Right. And if you look at, again, traditional data centers, they build redundancy into everything and failover mechanisms. And in some situations, they'll have two sets of power systems, substations.
Because if you lose power.
Yeah, yeah, right. And so it's designed.
The cloud goes down. What happens if you lose power?
Yeah, it's a funny story about that. I was at Crater Lake.
Okay.
And, we were checking in, and I asked the lodge receptionist there, do you have internet? My wife says, no, don't answer him. He should have no internet. I said, if I don't have internet, I have no way to communicate. If I have no way to communicate, there might be no internet for anybody. Not true.
You want to make sure you
have
internet.
That's not true, but it was just but anyway. So the reality is the way they used to design resilient data centers, and they still do, enterprise still does, is they have dual power cords for servers, then they have dual power systems, dual backup battery systems, dual generator systems, dual substation systems, and you look at all of the cost, dual cooling systems, all these things add up to a lot of cost. And think about this, you have more parts, more complexity. With more complexity, you have more failures. So
right.
you get this situation where you're not actually getting more reliable, it's actually working against you. And so the great thing about the cloud, and particularly the scale at which we operate, because we have data centers all over the place, the great thing about that is And the software expertise is we're putting the resiliency into the software where we can move load if there's a failure. We can we have multiple instantiations. We got global diversification. All these things are helping us, and the software is what enables that. And so, you know, there's no company better poised to deal with the software powerhouse that's needed to create this than Microsoft.
Right on. Well, we're glad to have you.
Yeah.
So what's next for data centers? Do you think there'll ever be a point where we don't need these things anymore?
Yeah, so that's an interesting question, because we do talk about the fact that really a data center is about computation. And at some point we were talking, well, wouldn't it be great if we could just use the extra capacity on your cell phone mm-hmm. or on your Surface.
They exist.
Yeah.
We know about
them. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. which, by the way, I have a few of the Surfaces, just to be clear. And even your PCs at home, that there's just this computation that's not being used 24/7.
Tap into that.
Could we tap into it? But the reality is, as we move forward, we start thinking about the fact that really computation and data, it's a resource. It's a utility. Mm-hmm. And even some of the things we're thinking about now, and I've coined this phrase called the data plant, is if you think about where data centers are today and where the utility is right now, the data center is nothing more than a power converter. We got electricity coming in, goes into the data center, and we got data coming out. And that's what gets distributed to the homes, the enterprise, or whatever. And that's really what we are. We're just a utility that's offering a more refined form of energy called data. Mm-hmm. And we're distributing it, rather than in power lines, we're distributing it in fiber. Well, if you buy into that fact, what we're looking at now, and we're doing some piloting in this area, is moving the data center and the power generator together.
Right.
And so we call that the data plant, right?
If we're going to use it the data plant.
Well, me and my team.
Gotcha.
Yeah, right. And so we start thinking about it more as a utility and just a different way to distribute energy. And the implications there, and things we're even talking about, is like flare gas. We blow off a bunch of flare gas, they flare it off because there's no economically viable way to take that energy, that low-grade gas, and convert it to, or pipe it out to somewhere where there's a power plant or the utility grid is $2 million a mile to build, whereas fiber is $10,000 a mile. So what we're looking at is, well, can we tap into this energy that's otherwise being burnt off and use that and put a data center there and then convert that and then just distribute fiber out from these, these different gas fields or whatever the case might be. So
right.
It really opens up some interesting opportunities.
Wow, well, I can't wait to learn more about it. Thank you so much for stopping by and talking to us about all that you do and all that you plan on doing. It's really interesting. Stay tuned for more from Christian Bilotti.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.